Hello everybody and welcome to today's webinar. The focus of our discussion today is digitalisation in the various economies around the world and the findings in our recent digital currents report. I'm Alex Brodie and I'll be chairing our discussion today in my capacity as co-lead of Gowling WLG's global tech sector, which I co-lead with David Brennan and Fiona Duncan. So thank you for sharing your time with us today. The rollout of new technology supporting digitalisation, as well as the influence of the recent COVID-19 pandemic, have really accelerated the shift towards digital technology being brought into not just advanced, but also traditionally so-called low-tech industries. And the focus of our recent report was to look at the jurisdictions where digitalization is thriving and therefore commercial opportunity thriving. And those where you could say work is still needed to embed the necessary regulation or investment or use of digital technology by major businesses, as well as us, of course, their customers. In the report, we also looked at several industries that are being heavily disrupted by the rollout of new technologies and which technologies are causing that disruption. So digital currents is an update on our previous waves of readiness, which ranks countries by several different metrics to help determine their level of readiness to embrace digitalization. And today I'm delighted to be joined by panellists with a real expertise in a myriad of different areas and markets, talk through where and why differences exist around the globe, how businesses can be proactive in seizing those opportunities and moving their own businesses and also their sectors forward through the use of technology. I'm absolutely delighted to be able to introduce you to Claudia Olsson, who made an invaluable contribution to our digital currents report through her discussion and expertise in Sweden's adoption of digitalization. And of course, it's no surprise that Sweden topped the wave of readiness. Claudia is CEO of Stella Capacity, a global education company specializing in digital upskilling and leadership. And she is one of the Nordic region's premier and most sought after speakers on exponential technologies, future trends, leadership, and governance. Her work has focused on the impact of new technologies on citizens, society, and global markets. And Claudia, thank you so much for spending your time with us today. I'm also thrilled to be joined by Chun Leng Tang, a partner in JurisAsia, who we are fortunate to be affiliated with in Singapore. Chun Leng is a specialist in corporate M&A, advising on complex multi-jurisdictional transactions in Southeast Asia, technology companies, and obviously those who wish to invest in them. Until 2 years ago, Singapore topped the wave of readiness in our report, and we'll be asking him why it has performed so well over time, but also how Claudia's Sweden has knocked it off the top spot. So we're looking forward to that debate between Claudia and Chun Leng. I'm also delighted to be joined by two of my very own sector specialists, John Norman from our Canadian team and also Sushil Kuna from our UK team. John is the co-head of our global life sciences team and a patent litigation specialist at heart. He's represented pharmaceutical, biotech, biologic and technology clients for the Federal Court of Canada, the Federal Court of Appeals and the Supreme Court of Canada. And Sushil is a fintech specialist with significant experience in financial services regulatory law. He spent 8 years working with the supervision and enforcement divisions of the Financial Conduct Authority. She's most certainly poacher turned gamekeeper. Her clients include banks, asset and fund managers, fintech companies, startups, corporates, private equity houses, platforms, and intermediaries. She really is my go-to person for regulatory in the fintech space. So, with that, Claudia, I'd like to start our discussion with a look at Sweden. Obviously the top-ranked country in our Waves of Readiness report. I mean, what in your view helped propel Sweden to the top? Is it private enterprise, government support, something else?
Great question. I would say that this is definitely a combination of both. So Sweden has a history of early recognizing the importance of investing in ICT infrastructure. We have been very early in making sure to roll out broadband. Currently, we have almost 100% internet penetration. We've also had governmental agencies really being quite innovative in getting the general population to become very accustomed and comfortable with using PCs using digital technologies. So one of the most known reforms that Sweden ran was the PC reform that was initiated in 1995, 1997, which enabled Swedes to actually be able to borrow home PCs from work, basically tax-free, to buy them at a very low cost, to enable as many participants of the economy, as many citizens as possible, to actually have access to their own PC at home. In addition to this, we've had a lot of different governmental initiatives focusing on making sure that Sweden could position itself as one of the most digital economies. In 2011, we had the Digitalisation Commission being formed, and Digitalisation Commission has been working very actively on making sure that Sweden becomes one of the best countries in the world at harnessing and capturing the opportunities of digitalization. Following the Digitalization Commission, we had another agency coming about, and this agency has been very active in actually making sure that all our other governmental agencies actually follow suit and become more and more digitalized. This agency is the Agency for Digital Development, and it's called DIG. In addition to this, we've had, for example, an innovation agency, which each year hands out a significant amount of money to support innovation in the ecosystem. And they identify areas that will be important for Sweden's economy going forward. So supporting innovation through smaller grants, and also supporting it by enabling collaboration between academia, private sector, and the public sector. Of course, the private sector has had a super important role to play as well. We had a great ecosystem being developed around Ericsson, our big telecom. We've had quite a few significant startups that led and that put the foundation for a very good basis for growth and more unicorns. So if we look at, for example, the entire community around Skype, where Sweden also played a role, we've had of course, the community around Spotify, companies like Klarna, many of them have been the first big giants, and the community around them has gone to invest in more startups, enabling more creative companies, both connected to music, to fintech, to many gaming industries, many creative industries as well. So it's definitely a collaboration. I would also want to highlight the Wallenberg Foundations as one of these entities in Sweden, which really contributes a lot to spurring innovation and collaboration. They basically have a holding companies where they have a lot of the major Swedish industry companies which pay dividends back to the foundations, and the foundations invest that in research in Sweden, focusing on areas like artificial intelligence, for example, to prepare us for what is to come. So I would say it's been both the public and the private sector contributing, and the collaboration has definitely been a success factor as well.
That's really interesting, that sort of holistic approach of private and public, with the government driving the way to create an environment where people can adopt these new technologies. And that has obviously given Sweden a phenomenal foundation. Do you think it's sufficient for it to continue at the top, or is it going to get steadily overtaken? Obviously, it was first out the traps. Is it staying there?
I of course hope it will be sustainable. We do have a lot of things in place that make a difference. For example, post-secondary education is free in Sweden. We have a relatively large percentage of the population that has PhD degrees. We have a lot of people going to science, innovation. That is a really good start for enabling great growth of ideas even going into the future. Sweden has also been working a lot to be a very attractive country for international talent that moves to Sweden. If we look at all our international companies like Spotify, Nordfold, that are growing fast now, many of them have really benefited from international talent that chooses to move to Sweden to establish here. That is also something I think will be a success factor for us going forward. But I would also say that Sweden's focus on innovative economies is an technologies is something that is also going to make a great difference. Our focus on green steel, our focus on developing solutions around energy storage. These are areas which attract great talents and which are super important for our future, where I think that we can have the largest impact as well. So by focusing on them, I think Sweden will be able to make a great difference. And in addition to this, we also have about 30 different test beds from different technologies and for companies to try them out. We have a lot of basically science parks collaborating across the country, creating great environments for new companies to grow from. And we have been relatively good at also reaching out and forming collaborations across the world. For example, with Singapore, we've had the great benefit quite recently to establish a collaboration with an accelerator in Stockholm, where Singaporean companies can come to Stockholm to establish and accelerate their business. So by forming these partnerships and by enabling talent to learn and to innovate, I hope that we will be able to continue to learn, to grow, and to stay at the forefront.
It all sounds so impressive and really exciting. I mean, aside from moving to Sweden, we just need to hear from Singapore. So, Chin Leng, Singapore led the rankings until last year when Claudia and her team took over. But obviously, Singapore is driving growth in the digitalization space, it remains second in the rankings. But in your opinion, what's driven that success? Is it similar things to what Claudia was mentioning, or other items?
Yeah, no, thanks, Alex. Great to be here. And actually, it was really good to hear from Claudia, because I think the general framework is not dissimilar. I think in Singapore's case, it's a small country, but it is a mid-sized city and it's in the midst of a very large regional economy. So I think the lessons, the experiences that Singapore has gone through, and certainly the mistakes that have been made around here, are certainly applicable to other cities and other states as well. So if you look at the partnership that Claudia very elegantly put together, you've got the government on one side and the private sector on the other. I think the government has not been party on that aspect as well. There's a certain level of top-down pressure from the government to companies as well. You see it most easily in the form of government grants. I mean, that's almost a low-hanging fruit where, you know, for certain plans, when it meets certain targets and there are certain KPIs fixed, you find that the government support to help companies in the digital transformation is there. So whether it's be something as basic as getting additional hardware or certain software subscriptions, to the point of actually working with the companies to appoint industry experts to help guide the company to its transformation, you find a whole slew of government grants and programs to support that. But other than just giving money, I think the government itself has also undertaken an industrial transformation roadmap across 6 different clusters in 23 different sectors, where they looked at each of them. So you had input from both the government and from the private sector to try to work out to then say, look, what makes sense? I think that's the next step. Acceptance by the government that look, they have some of the answers, but they certainly don't know what's happening on the ground. So they had to work together with the private sector to kind of come up with those roadmaps. We're in the early days of rolling out those roadmaps, but the initial results are encouraging in some sectors, but I think there are some sectors which the government has acknowledged needs further work already. But then even from the bottom up for companies, there's a certain sense of urgency as well. I mean, Singapore, if you look around the GDP growth rates of most of the Asian countries, there'll be anything between 5 to 10%. I mean, we live and see that every day around us and all. So I think for companies based around here, they do see there's a lot of urgency to, if they are ahead, stay ahead, but if they're not, certainly to try to get ahead of the regional competition. I think the last thing that has had some immediate impact, Alex, it's really the pandemic, right? I think that, and we've all heard this a number of times in terms of how much of the growth got brought forward. But I think one thing we saw around Asia is that in general, I think the Asian economy stayed in some form of lockup more than a lot of European and North American economies. Now, I mean, that forced everybody to go online, set up online shop, online demos, but not just within the country, but you find that travel within the region actually opened up only earlier this year. So there has been some time for a lot of companies around the region to then say, look, I'm not going to get customers over into our factories, into our demo shops. So what did we do? We had. So they were forced to, but you know, that's a silver lining there, I suppose.
Okay, thank you. So again, it sounds very similar, which is a clear government strategy backed by tangible investment, not just money, but also help and guidance in terms of you about appointing industry experts. looking at companies that are thinking of inbound investment into Singapore, what big trends, what macro trends should overseas businesses be aware of, do you think, when entering a Singaporean market?
That's a really big question, Alex.
Sorry.
And one that it's a good one, and I think we get asked that very often as well. I think the sense is that going back to the GDP growth, you could normalize it across COVID, but I think the amount of excitement, the amount of that sense that around Asia, the size of the markets and the populations around here, Indonesia, close to 300 million, Vietnam, about 100 million, and, you know, of course, there's obviously India and China that are much larger than that. But each of them is not only large, but many of them have very favorable demographics as well. So if you look at, in terms, if they look at the lifetime investment, right, if you were to make an investment in Asia now, how long do you think that investment would last and yield a good ROI? It's a really good number. I mean, we hear that from clients. So I think in terms of setting up in Singapore as a hub to then grow their Asian businesses, I think that has been true for some time, and we continue to see that. But even on the tech front, what we're seeing is that, and we've had the chance to go around the countries around Southeast Asia recently, and we haven't done so for about 3 years. And you find that excitement on the ground is very real. There's obviously commodities and some of the older industrial sectors, but anything with a tech-first focus remains exciting. I'm not sure it's red hot anymore. I think valuations across the board come down, but certainly that sense that if you can roll out a solution that addresses an issue within the local market, and they are often very large local market, there's still a lot of investor interest, there's still a lot of excitement, there's still a lot of growth that people are investing into.
Thank you. So I like the sound of that excitement, that engagement from the population, but also the business community in technology, sort of coupled with the investment and encouragement from the top down. And Claudia, obviously Sweden's doing brilliantly, but what do you think it could take from Singapore's example in this area?
I would say a lot. Singapore is definitely a country that has been extremely good at long-term planning and thinking that's putting into measures into place that will give fruit in 10 to 15 years, which is extremely impressive, looking at already what Mr. Lee Kuan Yew did starting there. That kind of long-term planning, I think a lot of nations would benefit from. But something that Singapore is also extremely good at doing is to attract great talent to the region. Singapore has been very good at also providing a testbed for a lot of different companies, a lot of different actors to come in and try new innovations. I was very early on impressed, for example, by how Singapore is making great contribution in the healthcare system by experimenting and developing new ways of teaching medicine. For example, with the Duke campus that was established in Singapore, where you could actually try new teaching models that were very digitally driven and enabled, and then try them out in Singapore and then export them and scale up across the world, also back to the US, for example. And that kind of platforms and test beds is something that I think many countries could learn from, contributing to and enabling, as well as Sweden. I think Singapore has also been very good at learning from other countries. I'm very impressed by how Singapore quite early on with sent delegations across the world, sharing their knowledge, but also bringing a lot of knowledge home and seeing what of that could be integrated in their own system. In our company at Stellar Capacity, we try to encourage a lot of people when they learn and when they are trying to regain digital skills, not only to learn from what is happening in Sweden or the nearest region, but actually to look across the globe in a similar way as Singapore has done, to bring back the best innovations, learn from them, implement them, and developing them further. So I definitely think we can learn a lot from Singapore. I also see that we can learn a lot from other regions that are really investing heavily and moving forward. If we look at India and China, for example, there is a tremendous progress going forward. There are a lot of really great educational programs. There's a lot of great accelerators, and there's a lot of innovations coming out from the region that is really important to observe and learn from. So I think that any country that wants to stay ahead and wants to embrace digitalization and understand the risks, but also to have a responsible growth should learn from other regions and try to see what you can learn from best practices to implement that back in the system. So I think Sweden is definitely on that path and on that track as well.
Thank you. It sounds so energizing. And if you could sort of pick one area of digitalization, which I know is incredibly hard to do, that you think, Claudia and Jinleng, that Singapore and Sweden could really take a charge on. Jinleng, what's your one for Singapore, if you had to pick just one thing?
It's not an exciting one, Alex, but a very crucial one, trade facilitation. I think many of us have looked at letters of credit and at the end of it, we've all seen pictures of the number of ships waiting to dock at certain yards and being held back because there wasn't enough manpower to deal with the ships and all that. I mean, it's obviously a sector that isn't going to go away as long as we actually want physical goods that are going to be manufactured somewhere else. But I think one of the things that Singapore has done recently was to really work with, again, working with the private sector to really try to streamline the process to make that as quick as possible. I mean, somebody just remarked that to me today, anytime you see a large boat sitting in the harbor somewhere off the coast, well, it's not making money either. It's not moving as it should. So anything that can be done to try to facilitate that, to try to reduce that turnaround time, is big money. And I think that's one thing which I think that the private sector and public sector here have come together and done quite well. And I think it's that kind of thing that I think should be shared around the world and to be learned from how others are benefiting from that or doing better and to try to improve.
Brilliant, thank you. And Claudia, for Sweden, what would you pick if you had to pick just one thing?
No, I think I would be expected to pick maybe a creative industry like the gaming industry or music or one of our more creative or potentially also fintech areas. But I think that the area where Sweden definitely is excelling now and where we're going to see a lot of impact in the coming years is with regards to connected industry and connected manufacturing. We have a lot of focus on really enabling automation of our industry. We have state-of-the-art factories like the one created, for example, by SKF. We have a robot valley that we have defined in basically middle Sweden, which is a hub, a cluster for a lot of both smaller companies, but also some of our larger industrial companies where there's a lot of cooperation happening, a lot of innovation in terms of how to use automation and different processes and how to enable that in a more sustainable way, but also a more safe and scalable manufacturing that can also be enabled and decentralized in many ways. Because if we're looking at the future of industry, we're definitely going to have to see the possibility to have smaller batches, much more complex solutions being created, but also not necessarily at scale in one part of the world, but also in more locations, being able to really have a connected industry and connected manufacturing across the globe. And I think that the innovation Sweden is developing in this space will make a mark. So that I would say that is an area which I think is important to follow going forward.
Thank you. And connected manufacturing, shipping, and the advantages Sweden and Singapore are enjoying, the word that you both keep mentioning is investment for public sector, private sector, which just brings us to Sushil, who's our fintech specialist. And obviously financial services have been arguably earlier and more thoroughly disrupted than a lot of other sectors in our economies, and so much so that obviously there's now a market for standalone financial services focused technology, quite apart from the financial services industry benefiting and embracing technology. So why do you think it's been first and quite so thorough, and given the amount of disruption you've seen in the last decade and more, what can other industries learn? I mean, how should they stand ready?
Thanks, Alex. Well, I think the paramount reason for why the fintech sector appears to be more developed and has a more mature market globally is because of the very nature of the financial services industry and the fact that traditionally it has comprised the large incumbents, which have grown over time through merger and acquisition, and whose decades-old legacy systems have been pieced together rather than fully integrated with one another over time. Now, with the lack of investment into streamlining systems and IT infrastructure, which was, I think, largely due to minimizing costs in an environment where regulatory barriers maintained that status quo and offered little incentive to invest. Legacy systems have really obstructed those traditional players from reacting to changing consumer demands and achieving the full potential of end-to-end digitalization, making financial services a ripe market for innovators to take advantage of, really. Now, new entrants have seen opportunities in disaggregating components of traditional financial services, offering more targeted solutions with better servicing to both retail consumers and businesses. So take, for example, the banking space, where challenger banks have made a huge impact. They've revolutionized the banking industry. They've been amassing customers to the point where they do now pose a credible threat to the incumbent banks. And how have they done this? It's not by offering anything new necessarily in terms of new products or services, but through ease of use, customer centricity, competitive pricing, and altogether a more personalized service, which is the result of innovative new technology and lower operational costs. By way of practical example, even further, setting up an account with a challenger bank often takes just minutes and is a really simple process to complete on your mobile phone device or your app with very little human intervention. And that's even accounting for your KYC processes. And compare that to traditional banking services. I mean, it could take days sometimes to open up a simple bank account. And especially in sort of Europe, I think policy changes have also helped to encourage innovation, particularly in the financial services sector, through initiatives such as open banking and PSD2, which have helped to bolster adoption of new ideas and the use of technology in the payment services industry to enhance competition for the benefit of consumers. PSD2, or the Second Payment Services Directive, as its full name, developed the concept of a single payment market in the EU and promoted the development of innovation in the payment sector through open banking. Now, under open banking, banks allow access and control of customers' personal and financial data to third-party service providers through the use of application programming interfaces, otherwise known as APIs. And this has been a complete game changer, as new players can access that consumer data and banking information, enabling them to offer new financial products and services more tailored to customers' needs and enable faster, for example, access to credit. Now, regulators around the world are recognizing the benefits of innovation, which has led to the creation of regulatory sandboxes designed to push innovation in financial services and allow firms to test new ideas on consumers and markets in a controlled environment. So it's interesting to hear from Claudia earlier, where she said that, you know, test beds have been really important in driving innovation. And that's very clearly demonstrated in the UK and global markets, where, you know, there are the creation of these regulatory sandboxes, which are designed to try and push and encourage innovation in financial services. They've also been recognizing the benefits of blockchain technology, for example, lower costs and faster and more secure transactions. And many blockchain based solutions are now being tested in those sandboxes, which is great news. You know, it will take some time to bed in, but the regulators will want to make sure that, you know, blockchain technology is being used effectively and sort of mitigating any potential harms that may be created by it. And with all this going on, traditional financial services firms are now being forced to invest into their own IT infrastructure, with the threat of being left behind if they don't find ways to compete with the fintechs. And all of this is helping to develop a mature market for standalone financial services technology. And what can other industries learn? Well, I think, as mentioned before, fintechs have focused on customer centricity and more personalized services by disaggregating those traditional and complicated financial products to offer them in a more streamlined and user-friendly way. So I think focusing on end outcomes, understanding consumers' needs, fostering inclusion, breaking things down, focusing on solutions and simplifying product offerings, they should all go a long way for other industries, really.
Thank you. Again, it's coming back to the individual, isn't it? There's investment you're talking about, but also engagement of the people, the human within all of this. So that's what's going on at the moment. if you're looking at more mature fintech markets, the ones that are further ahead, where are businesses thriving and where do you perceive regulation or investment to be lagging behind if you're looking at the more mature markets?
Yeah, so I've already mentioned open banking. So in Europe, open banking has really shaken up the banking and payment space. It's empowered customers to take control of their finances, make better informed decisions, manage their finances across multiple accounts through single applications and be able to make instant payments. It's also increased competition, thereby giving consumers more choice and lowering costs. But aside from banking, I mean, there are plenty of other areas of financial services which have demonstrated significant innovation. For example, InsurTech, where companies are selling insurance digitally, quote aggregators with all of the price comparison websites in the insurance market, not only insurance now, but mortgages and other financial services too. Wealth tech, which covers investment and management platforms, robo advice, sales and trading analysis tools, personal finance management tools, and more recently, those crypto asset exchanges. Now, the lending space too has been seeing great expansion in the number of fintechs offering quick and easy credit options, including the big buy now, pay later firms, one of which Claudia mentioned earlier, so big Swedish firm Klarna, who are really reshaping that credit sector. In terms of the one area of regulation, which I think is perhaps lagging behind a bit at the moment, is the area of crypto assets and decentralized finance, otherwise known as DeFi, where there is no consistent global framework for these at present. In the UK, the FCA started off by making clear that its rules are technologically neutral and set out some guidance as to the regulatory treatment of crypto assets under its current framework. However, as time moves on and the nature of crypto assets and business models evolve with greater and more complex adoption of crypto assets, for example, unregulated stablecoins are a key example at the moment, the government has recognised the need to legislate in this area to hedge against systemic risks, certain prudential gaps that might exist at the moment and potential market abuse risks. So we only have to turn to the recent sort of Terra UST crash, which was like an algorithmic stablecoin, which is really, you know, which showcases the extent of potential detriment these stablecoins can pose if not properly regulated.
Thank you. I think that's an amazing, that's a really good example of the issues, but also the advantages that regulation can bring, because so often people look to regulation and see it stifling creativity, but actually within the fintech space, it's been shown to create safe spaces for creativity to occur and people to trust. John, moving to your sector specialism, obviously, which is life sciences. I mean, life sciences businesses traditionally have not been seen as digitalized economies, but that's obviously changed enormously in the last few years. What can they learn from an area like financial services, which is obviously very far ahead of the game on digitalization and the disruption? And do you think there are special factors that apply to life sciences businesses that make it easier or harder?
Yeah, thanks, Alex. And I was actually thinking about this morning. And when I left medical research about 25 years ago, I was horrified to see some of these wet benches dismantled and computer terminals put in there. And I says, where are we going with this? And I guess that was just the tip of the iceberg. And, you know, is it a must have for certain businesses? Absolutely. For example, there are traditional AI computer companies that now call themselves tech bio. They're based around AI entirely. And now they've moved into the life sciences space and they're partnering with pharma companies. So for those companies, it is absolutely critical that they use AI because it's essentially the core of their business. On the pharmaceutical space, we're seeing increased use throughout the platform. For example, Sushil mentioned API. In my world, that's called active pharmaceutical ingredient. And they're using AI to design new active pharmaceutical ingredients. They're looking at databases, to, you know, old medicines, can they have new uses? So AI is digging into that. They're looking at how medicines fold in the body for proteins. They're looking at other things such as clinical trials. You can look at a clinical trial and determine with AI how the clinical trial is being run, which patients are benefiting, what their characteristics are. So really neat application. You've also got supply chain management. Wouldn't have thought that, you know, AI would be important for that, but you know, with limited drugs and, for example, in the vaccine space, clearly supply chain management was really huge in COVID-19. And also, you know, process for formulating and making. Again, AI is being used in that. So in my view, the pharma industry has erupted with AI and it's just going to become more and more increasingly used.
So there's probably no such thing as just life sciences anymore, is it? It's life sciences and tech.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Fantastic. So, and obviously, life sciences are a heavily regulated industry through history. So she'll just come back to that regulation point. What do you think less developed fintech markets at the moment could learn from more mature markets in relation to regulation?
Well, I think the UK regulators are often pointed to as one of the key facilitators of London's position as a global fintech leader. The FCA has a strategic objective in law to make markets and financial services work well. And to do that, it needs to ensure the integrity of markets, protect consumers and promote competition in the interests of consumers. And in promoting competition, it promotes innovation as it recognises that it is competition and the innovation spurred by it that challenges incumbents. Innovation provides better outcomes for consumers and better value products and services. How that process of competition takes place is often determined by the market, but regulation has a part to play in making sure the right conditions exist for that competition. And through the FCA's project Innovate, the FCA helps firms tackle regulatory barriers to innovation, be it through clarifying regulatory expectations, examining its own rules or enacting policy changes to give them space to innovate in the interests of consumers. It was also the first regulator to establish a regulatory sandbox, which allows firms, as I said earlier, to test those innovative propositions in the market with real consumers through a controlled testing environment, potentially enabling them faster routes to market at potentially lower costs. Now, the FCA also regularly hosts a number of tech sprints, which is designed to get firms, academics, and innovators in a room to try and find solutions on current issues. Recent tech sprints have revolved around sustainability and solutions to overcome challenges faced by regulators in monitoring ESG data and disclosures. But the next tech sprint is designed to focus on solutions for authorised push payment frauds. And the Bank of England too has a fintech accelerator. And so regulators globally can really learn from those initiatives in driving their agenda really on innovation.
Thank you. The tech sprint sound like a really good idea. So Chinleng and Claudia, looking back to obviously Singapore and Sweden as our leaders in this space, what regulatory changes are ongoing at the moment in your countries that do you believe are supportive of this growth, digitalization, supporting technology? I don't know, Claudia, in Sweden, what's the big thing that's happening in regulation at the moment?
I would mention three different initiatives that are definitely also connected to what has happened on the European level. And the first one is the work towards defining a blueprint for a single digital gateway. A single digital gateway that will enable us, for example, to share everything from graduation certificates between countries. So when students move in the Erasmus system, for example, they are able to show their qualifications. The single digital gateway is also enabling us, for example, that when we identify with all our credentials, addresses, etc., for one public agency, we wouldn't have to repeat that for every single public agency we're involved with, but that is something that is automatically transferred and accessible throughout the system, and hopefully also across Europe going forward. So that is something that we're seeing on an integration level across Europe, and I think that will really enable a lot of innovation as well going forward. The second initiative I would also mention on the European level is the definition of the AI Act that the European Union is working on. And that is really thinking ahead around artificial intelligence and the responsibility we have to manage the risks that AI brings about, spurring AI innovation, but also thinking about how we need to be proactive about the usage of AI, the reliability, the transparency around how different systems are developed, built, and for what purpose. And that is something very, very interesting, where we definitely are laying the ground foundation for how a very important technological development will be able to impact us in Europe going forward. I think a lot of people across the world are wondering about how do you really regulate AI ethics, and this is an important initiative towards that goal. I would say that the third initiative that is 2-3 years old already, but is still in progress and implementation, is to make sure that across all public services, they only accept e-invoices. So all invoices need to be electronically sent, and the process is completely digitally run when the public system is procuring different services and products. And that is empowering and enforcing that all the suppliers across Sweden is also becoming more digital, using the digital system, and also gaining more digital skills. So these are three of the initiatives, and I think that we will be developing those in parallel and in collaboration with many other European countries, and hopefully also beyond that.
Thank you. It's about creating the right environment, isn't it? Chin Leng, what's going on in Singapore?
I think the first one of the things I've realized here is that clearly the government between Sweden and Singapore have already taken Claudia's advice, and in terms of exchanging notes and ideas, because there's certainly a lot of similarity. I think one key area that the government has implemented a few years ago and is still rolling out is really they had four pillars where they said that we need to create the foundational aspect to allow a digital economy to flourish. Right. And if you think about it, it will make a lot of sense. And it's the four areas. The first one is in terms of creating a digital identity for each, not just a company, but for each citizen. So that, you know, much as we are represented in the physical world, that on the digital world, you know, we have, you know, you see the Chun Ling you have here, you should have a digital Chun Ling as well. Related to that is the idea of authentic authorization and consent. There's no point interacting with me if you can't interact with the digital me and have me say yes or no digitally. So how do you then try to have a check and balance to make sure that that process isn't abused? The third one, and this is probably crucial, and this is really Sushil's area of expertise, is in terms of payments interoperability, to make sure that you can't have different systems. You can have different systems, but if they don't talk to each other, then you're going to get a very fragmented digital economy, which is something that they clearly want to try to avoid. So that was the third piece. The fourth one's a bit more challenging. It's really about data exchange, right? We know we've got all this information flowing across each other and all. And, you know, we've been on this topic for a number of years already. And I understand, like, this really, we know very well as well, in terms of when it comes to privacy, and then the issues around it. How do you then allow the exchange of information across borders in some cases, but yet retain the ones that you don't want to have exchange? I mean, that's still an ongoing process, and I think they've identified this four as probably the key areas that they want to build on. And then if you go a little bit further afield, I mean, sandboxes is something which I think we talk about a lot in the fintech space, but now you're finding that's expanding to many areas as well, whether it's on the bio side and on the AV side, to start creating the areas where if something fails, you know, it fails within a controlled environment, but you then get to learn from it and innovate from there. And then reaching further out areas like, I think similar to what Claudia mentioned again, in terms of AI. I mean, it's happening in limited industries right now, but in terms of trying to find something omnibus that can more, has a greater general application, it's a little bit of the holy grail in terms of AI regulation right now. And I think it's something which is going to need a lot more time and process to try to come up with something that more and more of us feel comfortable.
I think it's so important. It's about people feeling comfortable and trusting. John, you were mentioning about, you know, the wet benches turning into laptops just a moment ago, and both Claudia and Chin Leng have just mentioned AI. And I was thinking about where regulation doesn't quite touch what you need it to touch. How do businesses, particularly life sciences businesses that you're so immersed in, how do they protect their R&D, their innovation, and in particular around the AI space, if you wanted to just touch on that in the context of life sciences?
Sure, and it's absolutely a critical question that pharma companies are asking themselves, because as you can imagine, you don't want to do a clinical trial using AI, go before the regulator, and the regulator says, I don't like this data, do it again. I mean, you've just thrown away years and years and expense and that sort of thing. So the thing that we are really seeing is companies in this space are engaging with the regulators early on. When they start to develop the technology, They have stakeholder meetings. They're working closely with EMA, with Health Canada, with the FDA, the various regulators to see how the regulators are considering these data, how AI can be accepted. And, you know, the ultimate goal is to have a product that's approved because it's safe and effective. And what the regulators are looking at is the risk sufficiently low so that the benefit makes sense? And that's kind of where a lot of this is being driven by. So we always tell companies, listen, engage in these stakeholder meetings. They're critical. It helps develop the guidance going forwards. And if you're part of that process, you can fit, you know, fit into the guidance that's going forwards. The other thing, when we see companies getting ready to use AI, engage with the regulators early. Talk to them, see if this is an acceptable way of moving forwards. Sometimes little tweaks early in the process before you do a clinical trial can make all the difference in the world, and it makes it a lot smoother.
Thank you. It's very good advice. And Sushil, what do you see where there's maybe a gap in the regulation or lack of regulation? How do companies protect their investment in technology?
Yeah, I'd say in certain industries, in particular in financial services, which are fast evolving, I think you need to research the markets, take legal advice as the current state of play within that market, and keep an eye on regulatory developments in the jurisdictions you're operating in. Prime examples of forthcoming regulatory changes in the UK are in the buy now, pay later credit fields, which are dominated by the fintechs such as Klarna and PayPal, and which will shortly see currently unregulated products coming within that regulatory perimeter. And also crypto assets is another area where the law is drastically evolving. So conducting regulated activities without the relevant permissions is a criminal activity in the UK. And so it is really imperative that firms operating those markets keep up to date with regulatory developments, as they may not even have a business to protect in the end.
Not an ideal outcome. So it's been really interesting listening to Claudia. You talk about Sweden's, you know, just meteoric rise here, and Chun Leng, Singapore's undoubted dominance over a long period of time and yet to come. And then John, how the life sciences industry is coming forward with digitalization. And obviously, Sushil, you've got a mature market there with in terms of technology and finance. And there's some themes that are coming out. And I just wanted to have these play to you. It seems to me that what's common in each of your areas is a holistic strategy. There's a blueprint for success. Someone's decided what good looks like, and then they're fitting the other pieces in around it. And in some of those, that's government, and others it's money talking, and others it's big business and maybe three or four visionaries at the helm of those big businesses. But the strategy seems to be underpinned, Claudia, in particular with real practical measures, such as, you know, the laptops for all Swedish citizens, or the appointing of external experts to assist in various things. And implemented through regulation and legislation. I was particularly interested by the notion of paying dividends back into R&D institutes to make sure the money flows further into the creative. But ultimately, I don't know how you all feel about this or what your view on it is. It seems to come back to me for people, and they need to be educated, they need to be encouraged. They need to be people centricity, Sushil, your word. They need to be enabled to take part with the laptops, Claudia, and they need to be able to trust. And I think that's where governments bring forward clarity, openness, regulation, safety nets. So me, it seems very holistic. You need strategy, you need implementation, but if you can't bring the people with you, you're not getting anywhere. I don't know how that chimes with you or John.
Yeah, no, that's a great question, because one of the challenges that the pharma sector is facing is the lack of qualified people to do this. So you almost need someone who is, you know, used to AI and computer sciences and also understands pharmaceuticals and you know, the drug development process. There are not very many people that have that qualification, and those that have that qualification are in extremely high demand. So you can imagine, you know, all the companies are going after a very small pool of fish. As this area gets more and more advanced, you will find more people that are qualified, and then you will find that the resources will be there. But I think right now in the pharmaceutical sector, the big challenge is actually the resources, and that opens up for partnering. So you see a lot of smaller startup companies that have the expertise that are partnering with the pharmaceutical companies, and that's how they're driving it forwards, because they can't develop the people in-house to do it right now.
Thank you. Sushil, what do you think? Is it the people or is it something else?
No, I completely agree with that. And there are similarities with what John was saying in terms of the financial services space as well, because, you know, like the incumbents right now, some of them, I mean, how are they trying to develop and sort of change their infrastructure? Are they suddenly getting that in-house experience themselves, or are they more realistically acquiring the fintechs, which is, there's a lot of that activity going on at the moment. So they need to compete with the challenger banks now, especially the banking industry. And the way that a lot of them have been doing that, it's not really by educating their current staff, it's by quickly acquiring some of the fintechs that can quickly address some of the issues that they're facing and bring those solutions to market really quickly. But even then, I mean, if we focus on the UK again, I mean, you know, especially in the context of Brexit, the UK government has made it clear that it wants to be like a hub for fintechs, and specifically a hub for crypto asset businesses too. And in terms of its initiatives, it has proposed those sort of tech visas as well to make sure mm-hmm. they're attracting the right talent to the UK, and we can quickly get that talent in to support the fintech industry in the UK too.
Thank you. And Chin-Leng, in Singapore, is it people, do you think, that are going to move this furthest, or money or strategy, or where are you?
It always comes back down to the people, I think. You know, you could have the best technology and all, but you don't have the right group that can make the most of it, and all, it gets a little bit wasted. I think John touched on it very well. You find across the sector, one of the things we found during the last 2 years is that you had companies big and small who were often coming up with an app or a new software or something to kind of get around the issue. And it's not unusual that they then have a development team offshore. It could be in Vietnam, it could be in Israel, it could be in Bangladesh. But to find that talent, right, the message almost was, I don't care where they are, but they can do what I need them to do. So I need their help on it. And those who can find that talent are always the ones who get to move ahead. I mean, we get to see that so often, you know, it's really encouraging, and it does say a lot about the innovative spirit of so many people. I mean, it's easy to look at the Great Resignation and say, well, where are we going to go from there? But dig a little bit deeper. I think a lot of people who have been involved in those resignations, part of this, they've moved on to something better.
Thank you. And Claudia, coming back to Sweden, as we must, what's your view? Is it the people or is it something else?
I think people make a tremendous difference. And it's also the people that are building the companies that are to constitute the government. So it's definitely the people we need to start with. And that's why I think that education matters so much. We need to enable people to learn, and not just in the beginning of their lives, but really focus on lifelong learning, embracing new technologies, learning as we go along, and really see that as a trend for our entire careers and something we need to continue doing. So, people and learning, I think, is key to successful progress.
Thank you. Claudia, Sushil, John, Chin-Leng, it's been a real privilege to have shared this hour with you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Alex. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you very much.